पेंट विंडो इज विजिबल टू एवरीवन। In the last session, we have seen convergence of infix to prefix with the help of string reversal and applying postfix format. And then we have seen introduction of queue, right? So now let's in the while ending the session, we discussed that there is a limitation of a regular queue that once you reach or once you make the queue full, after that we are not able to insert any new elements into the queue. So formally, if let's say I am implementing a queue with the help of array, so let's say this is the array that I'll be making use of. Okay, and let's say these are the indexes. This is the index 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And initially, as we are making use of array to implement the queue, like we have implemented a stack using the array, we can implement the queue also using an array. So what I'll do is, in the case of a stack, we have created one index called as a top. In here, I'll create two indexes called as one is called as in a front and other one is called as in a rear. For the sake of simplicity, I will refer the first alphabets F and R, so front and rear, and I'll initialize these both things to -1. Again, it's up to the programmer's logic how you are implementing the code. In the case of a stack, also we have seen that initializing the top with the -1 and or with the 0, you can tweak with the code and get the same result. So in this case, I am initializing F and R, front and rear, both values to -1. And in the last session, we have made it clear that we will be removing using the front index. If we want to remove anything from the queue, we will be using front index, and the rear index will be used for the insertion. So if I want to insert, I will use the rear index. If I want to remove, I will use the front index. Now, when the queue operation starts, let's say we are calling a enqueue operation. Okay, and we are saying I want to insert 11, enqueue 11. In the queue. Now, when we call enqueue operation with the 11, the enqueue method, this method must check like a pseudo code. Somebody may write a pseudo code like this. You have enqueue method with number, and in the enqueue method, first of all, you have to see that whether there is a queue is full of what. Right, so we are inserting a number in the queue, and as I said, the insertion will happen using the rear index. So the primary condition to check whether the queue is full or not is check whether the rear is less than the size of the array. So in this case, let's write what is the size of the array. So we are having one more indicator called as size, and in this case, the size of the array is 5. So let's see what is the value of rear, whether it is less than the size of the array or not. To be very specific, as we are dealing with the indexes, I should see size -1 because I am starting my index with the 0 -1 value. So I should check that the size of the array -1 should be the indicator to verify whether there is a space in the queue or not. So I'll say if here you may call a function whether queue is full or not. Is full, okay, is queue full. So if you prepare this function, then is queue function, what it can do is, let's say I am saying integer is queue full is the function which we are calling. So here what I can check is whether rear index is equal to size of the array -1. And if it is not, if this condition is not, if let's say not, if not, then insert the value. Then if this condition is false, if this con is it's not true, then rear plus plus, and let's say the array is declared with the name called as queue of R is equal to number. Q of R is equal to number. So this could be the pseudo code for enqueuing the number in the linear queue. So you must check whether the R is pointing to the index, which is just one less than the size, indicating that the queue is full. If it is not that, if the queue is not full, just increment the real value by one and insert the new number. So this is how you can enqueue the element in the queue using the C language or using the programming, any programming language, right? So this should be the pseudocode representation to enqueue a number. Now, there is an operation called as dequeue. Let's say I'm not passing any argument to the dequeue function. Now, what dequeue has to do? Dequeue can remove. Now, dequeue means you are in a phase of removing a number from the queue. In the phase of insertion, we have checked the rear index. In the phase of removal, we have to check the front index. Now, if the queue is empty, then you can't remove anything from the queue. Now, in this case, the queue can be marked as empty if your front is pointing to minus one. So this should be the only indicator that we can use. Right now, it's a linear queue and we can only proceed in one direction. That is the assumption that we will be going from the least index to the highest index, that is 0 to 4. So if the front index is not pointing to minus one, that means there is an element in the queue and you can remove that element. So in simply here, what I can say, if front is not equal to minus one, if front is not equal to minus one, what we can say, just print the number which has been removed, print Q of front, the number which you are removing, and here you can say front plus plus. So what will happen is you are printing the number. Let's say we have enqueued 11 right now with the enqueue 11. Let's say we have inserted 11 value in the queue. So when we call dequeue function in the enqueue, the front and rear, both indexes will start pointing to the value 0. Okay. So one condition in the enqueue should also be this. Like if the front is pointing to minus one, that means the queue is null and you should increment both front and rear. So when front and rear are pointing to zero value, and if you call dequeue function, then there is only one element in the queue. There is only one real element in the queue. So in the case of dequeue, we can take care of that, not only checking that front is not equal to minus one, we have to also check the condition that front and rear are not same. Front and rear are not same. So if front is not equal to rear. So if these both conditions are satisfying, we will execute this code that we will print that the number which is popped is Q of F, and then we will say F plus plus. But in the case if one of this condition is not matching, let's say front and rear are same. If front and rear are same, let's say if front and rear both are pointing to same value, let's say if front is equal to rear and they are not equal to minus one, and they are not equal to minus one, front and rear is equal to, they are same and they are not pointing to the value minus one, it means there is only one index or there is only one value in the queue. So in this case, when this condition is true, that front is equal to rear and the both are not pointing to minus one, it means that just print the number which you have popped out from the queue, or sorry, removed from the queue. That is, let's say Q is the array name and front value. And after that, let's set front is equal to minus one and rear also minus one, because you have nothing remaining in the queue after removing this element. So if they both are pointing to same value and they are not pointing to minus one, it means that there is only one element in the queue. Just remove that element. In this case, we will be removing 11. So what will happen after this dequeue operation is this 11 will be removed from the array. So 11 will be removed from the array, and front and rear, both will start pointing to minus 1. So now I can say that again front and rear both are pointing to minus 1. Okay, now let's add multiple elements and revisit this pseudocode. So let me create a clean sheet. What I can do is, let's assume this is the array with some indexes, let's say 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And now you know what is the NQ and what is the DQ. Okay, so I'll say NQ 11. So of course in NQ 11, initially front and rear, okay, thank you. So for front is equal to minus 1 and rear is equal to minus 1. So after enqueuing operation, we know that initially both are pointing to minus 1 index. So if the enqueue operation is executing on the empty queue, or the when the queue is having no element, zero elements in the queue, then in both this case, when both are pointing to the same value, and that is minus 1, indicating that the queue is empty. In this case, after enqueuing the element, let's say we are enqueuing 11 in the queue, we should take care of incrementing both front index and rear index to by 1. So I will say front is equal to 0 as well as rear equal to 0. So this is one of the corner case that we are inserting into the empty queue, and we are incrementing both front and rear because earlier there was no element in the queue and now we have inserted one element in the queue. Now let's say second value that we will be inserting. Let's again I call NQ operation and I'll say 12. Now front is not equal to rear, front is equal to rear, but they are not equal to minus 1. Now still front and rear value both are pointing to the same index, that is 0, but they are not pointing to minus 1. This means that there is an element in the queue and there is only one element in the queue. So this condition specifies that there is only one element in the queue. This condition specifies that the queue is empty. So when both are pointing to minus 1, it indicates that the queue is empty. When both are pointing to the same index, it means that there is only one element in the queue. So when there is one element in the queue, and of course the R, that is rear index, is less than the size minus 1. So what is the value of size minus 1? Let's say size minus 1 is another indicator. So size minus 1, this will result into 3. So here we can say that rear is front and rear are same, but they are not equal to minus 1, and R is less than 3, less than or equal to 3. So when R is less than or equal to 3, in that case, we can insert one, less than 3. So when the R is less than 3, we can increment the rear and enqueue the new element. So in this special condition, we are not going to increment both front and rear. We are going to just increment only rear value. So I'll say rear plus plus, and I'll insert 12. So after this operation, the new state of the front and rear shall be like this. So front will be pointing to 0 and rear will be pointing to the index 1. And when there is a difference in the index, front index and rear index, we can say that there are more than one elements in the queue. So the more than one element, okay, number of elements is equal to more than one. Okay, now if we again enqueue, again, all the conditions that they are not pointing to minus 1, they are not pointing to the same index, of course, and rear is still less than the size minus 1. Size minus 1, that is 3. So still, we can increment the R plus plus. So as rear value, R value is less than 3, we will again say R plus plus, and we will enqueue the new number, that is 13 in the queue. Okay, so we have inserted 3 values in the queue. Let's try to remove one value. So if now I will call a DQ function. Now if I'm calling a DQ function, it means that I should check the front index. I should remove the values from the front index. Now front index is not pointing to the minus 1. Front index is pointing to some other value. So when front index is not pointing to minus 1, for sure the queue is not empty. So this condition is not true, that front is not equal to minus 1. So definitely there is element in the queue. So we have crossed this condition. First condition is not satisfied. So there is an element in the queue. Now the second condition is whether front and rear both are pointing to the same element. Now front is 0, but rear is not 0. Rear is pointing to the index 2. After this insertion, the new value of the front and rear will be front is still at the 0 and the rear is pointing to 2. So this is the new state of the front and rear index. Now in the DQ, the front and rear are not same. They have a difference. They have a difference. That means we can just say F plus plus, which will point to the next index, and the element pointed by F of 0, front of 0, will be considered as removed from the queue. So before saying F plus plus, we will take care of printing the message that let's say this array is called as Q array. Then we will say that print Q of F is been removed from the queue, and we will say F plus plus. Now F is pointing to 0, F is currently pointing to 0, and the rear was pointing to this second index. We are saying F plus plus. It will shift the front pointer from the 0th index to the 1 index. So now the new position of F will be index 1. This means that we are changing the index value just by incrementing it by 1, and we will consider the 0th index or the presently front index, whatever the value was, is been removed from the queue. Now this is the new state of the queue. After this operation, the new state of the array will look like this. So there are 5 indexes. So this is the 12, this is the 13, this is my front, and this is the rear. Sorry. So let's enqueue one more value. Let's say I'm enqueuing 14. And after that, I say enqueue 15. So after enqueuing two values, of course, we are going to say rear plus plus. So every time I enqueue, I'll say rear plus plus. So after these two operations, the updated status step by step will be front will start still pointing to 1, and rear will be pointing to index 3 after the first insertion of 13. 13 is there, so 14, sorry, I have to insert 14. So 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So R will be pointing to index 3, and front is still pointing to 1. This is after inserting 14. Now let's insert 15. After inserting 15, again, I have to do R plus plus to insert that. So R plus plus to insert 15 will make that front is still pointing to 1, and R will point to 4 now. Now, as soon as R comes to the fourth last index, we are not equal to size less than minus 1. Of course, 4 minus 1 is 3. So as soon as you reach the last index, and if we now try to insert one more element, let's say enqueue 16. Now, if I'm saying enqueue 16, what is the algorithm? Algorithm says that the front and rear must not be pointing to the same element. That is the first check we are making, sure that we are adding to the queue wherein there is a space. Then the rear, we can still insert the element at the rear. How to check that? The size of the queue, which is size minus 1, what is the maximum index value wherein we can insert the number is, size of the array is 5, 5 minus 1 is 4. So let's check whether my rear value is equal to 4 or less than 4. But after inserting this 15th index, we have already reached the R is equal to 4 value, which is indicating that this is the last location which is present in the array. So as soon as we hit to the last location which is present in the array, we cannot say R plus plus because there is no space available to accommodate 16. Now here we have to give the message that the queue is full. So at this call, your program should handle the condition that the array is full. Not the array is full, we should print the message queue is full. Why we are printing the message queue is full? Because the R value, the rear value, is equal to the size of the array minus 1, which is indicating the last index of the array, right? Any doubt till this? Any doubt till this? Why we are seeing the queue is full? Yeah, I guess I'll stop something. Okay, thank you. So now let's continue with the queue. Now we know that this is not going to success because the queue is full. Let's try to dequeue. Okay. So I will start executing dequeue operations. Let's execute two dequeue operations. So this is the present state that we have. This is the present state we have. Now just let me zoom out a bit. Now after two dequeue, or let's say what will be the status of queue array after this first dequeue operation. So again, I'll write this array here. We have five locations, 0, 1, 2, 4 and 5. So 0, 1, 2, 3 and 4. Present situation was front is this and the R is this. And now we are saying dequeue. So sorry, R is here, not here. R is indicating that the queue is full. And to be very specific, there are elements like 12 is there, here it is 13, 14 and 15. Now in the case of a dequeue, we will check that the front and rear, they must not point to -1, indicating that the queue is empty. So we are not going to insert anything in the, sorry, remove anything from the queue, which is empty. So obviously the front and rear, they must not point to value -1, which they are right now not pointing to. That means the queue is not empty and there is something that we can remove. Before removing, we will check another condition, whether the front and rear are pointing to the same value. In this case, they are not even pointing to the same value. Front is pointing to the index 1 and rear is pointing to index 4. If they are pointing to the same value, that is front and rear are pointing to same index, that means there is only one element in the queue. In that case, what we can do is we can set front and rear to -1. So again, this condition is not true, that front and rear are not pointing to the same value. So what simply we will do is we will say F++. So front is pointing to index 1 and rear is pointing to index 4. To dequeue element from the front, I will just say front++. So what will happen after this? The new state will be, so there is an element 3, 4, 11 was there, which is removed, 12 was there, now it will be considered as removed, and the new front of the queue will be 13, and there are still 3 elements. So front will be pointing to 13 and the rear will be pointing to 15. So again, the next dequeue operation will be executed. Now all this history jargon that we have discussed while dequeuing 12, this all jargon will be again tested, like whether we are having empty or they are pointing to same thing or not. And if they are no, these all conditions are false, that means we will simply say F++. Again, this front index will move from 13 to 14. So after this second dequeue operation, the new status will be front will be pointing to 3 and rear will be pointing to 4. And this is after F++. Let's perform one more dequeue. So obviously the new state will look like this. So we have array wherein there were 5 locations, and earlier the front here, after this removal, front was pointing to the 14th index. After one more dequeue operation, the front and rear will reach the same index. Front is equal to rear is equal to 4. And these all elements which were present in the array will be considered as they are dequeued, they are removed. Now, when we start testing the conditions again, whether the front and rear both are pointing to -1, indicating the queue is empty. Now, this condition is false because front and rear are not pointing to -1. But here, second condition is matching. What is the second condition? Whether front and rear both are pointing to the same index or what? Yes, front is equal to 4 as well as rear is also equal to 4. What it means is that there is only one element in the queue. So we are not going to say F++ in this case, as we have done in the earlier cases. What we should do is we should say it directly, front and rear will start indicating the -1 value. Front will be equal to rear equal to -1. And it will consider that the array is completely empty now. Now, again entire array is pointing to the empty memory. So entire queue is been used. We have inserted elements in the queue and we have removed the elements from the queue. So this is how the queue works. In this queue, now if front and rear both are pointing to minus one, then this might be the case that we may think of again running the algorithm and start using the same array. But the problem in this scenario is if I have at least two elements in the array, let's say this was the array, this is the array I have. So this is the zeroth index, this is the 1, 2, and let's say in the third index my front is there, and in the fourth index there is a rear, and here it was 14th and 15th. Now we know that by rule front and rear are, front is pointing to 3 and rear is pointing to 4. By rule there are three locations available for the storage: index number 0, index number 1, and index number 2. But as the front and rear both are pointing to some other indexes like 3 and 4, we cannot just shift these elements to the earlier locations. This happens in the real life that the person takes the next place and the earlier position is available for the next occupant, which is in queue. No problem. That's how it works. But in the case of computer, it's not going to happen automatically. So the programmer has to take care of, if programmer wishes, what he can do is he can write algorithm to shift these elements from the third location to the second location, and from the second to the one, and from the one to the zero. But that's not how the queue works, right? So queue is just like inserting at the rear and removing from the front. That's it. That's the queue. If we start shifting the elements, then we cannot can no longer call it as an queue data structure. So that's not possible. So this is the limitation, that even if there is a space in the queue, you can't insert the new values inside the queue. This is a regular queue or a linear queue. Is there any doubt? So if I have to say that what is the limitation of the queue, this is the limitation of the queue, that even if there is a space available, you can't utilize that space. If the front has already passed that particular index, that is index number 0, 1, 2, they are available, but my front index is already pointing to 3. In this case, it cannot come back to the 2, or cannot come back to the 1, or cannot come back to the 0. To occupy these locations again. Are you with me? Any doubt in this? Any doubt till this time? Till this particular theory part? What is NQ? What is DQ? How the front and rear should be managed? Shall we proceed with something called as a circular queue? This particular drawback of wastage of a space is handled by a concept called as a circular queue. Instead of shifting, we have a mechanism using which we can manage the indexes in such a way that these empty locations can be utilized. But before that, before proceeding with the circular queue, is the simple linear queue is clear to you? Or if anyone have a doubt, please ask. Shall we proceed with circular queue? Chat mein dikhun nahi. Am I audible? Okay, thank you. Okay, so let me start with the circular queue. So again, we have similar array, like let's say I have array of 5 elements, or let's say this time we will make array of 4 elements. 0, 1, 2, 3, and array sizes, what is the maximum index which we have checked in the earlier cases is minus 1. In this case, it will be 3, because size is 4 minus 1 equal to 3. So this might be the formula to the specify what is the maximum index. Okay. Now, similarly, again, we will be starting with front is equal to rear is equal to minus 1, indicating that the queue is empty. So this condition is at the start is true. So we will perform an operation called as NQ. So NQ, let's say 11, we are NQing the first element. So as soon as we NQ the first element, the new state of the array is 11 has been inserted, and front and rear both are pointing to the same index, which is 0. Now let's say we enqueued one more element, nq, 12. Let's say this will get inserted. Now the new state of the array will be front is still at 11 and the rear is at 12. Now see how we are, how we have seen in the earlier cases, we are just saying plus plus. So if we say r plus plus to insert and f plus plus to remove, this is how we have proceeded. Now what is a limitation in these cases? Once you reach to the last index, once you reach to the last index, you cannot come back to the zeroth index. Then that condition will, to manage that kind of a program will be a difficult task. But there is a simple formula using which you can come back from the last index to the first index. So for that, let's perform some insertions and removal to understand what will be the states. Or let me just assume that we have performed some NQ and DQ operations and we have arrived at this particular stage. So what is the stage? Let's say the array size is 4 and the front is here and the rear is here. Okay, and let's say in the array we have 12, 13 and 14. Now this is a classic situation. In the earlier case, in the simple queue, we were not able to use this. We were not able to use this particular location. Now there is a formula. Instead of saying R++, if I say R++, current index is 3 and you cannot go to the fourth index because array do not have that space. So the formula is, let's say if R is not pointing to minus 1, if R is not pointing to minus 1, or if front and rear are not same, so the both condition has to be checked again, because no, front and rear, that will be fine if I'm inserting, no problem. So front and rear are not pointing to minus 1 means that the queue is empty, that's fine. So if I have to insert, okay, the earlier case was, if I want to insert, I should make sure that the rear is not equal to size minus 1. So this should be the case to make sure that the queue is not full. This is the condition to check that whether the queue is full or what, whether the queue is full. And if this condition is true, then the queue is full, else the queue is not full. But in this case, if I say Q, whether R is equal to size minus 1 or what, no, that's not true because R is already at 3. So what I can do is, I can say that R is equal to R plus 1 mod, let this size. So in this case, my current index is 3 plus 1. And the size of the array is 4. So what will be the ultimate equation is, ultimate equation is 4 modulus 4, which will result into 0. And now this should be your index wherein you can go from the rear value. So my rear, if we apply this formula, what will be the new rear value? What will be the new rear value? If we apply this formula, that is current index plus 1 mod 4, I can come from this last index, which is 3, back to the zeroth index. So this R value will travel back to the front. Now, after this insertion, after this NQ operation, let's say, after this NQ operation, this will be the new state. So after the insertion, this will be the new state. Okay, so front is here, 12, 13 and 14, and let's say I've inserted 15. Now here, rear is on the left side of a front, or rear index is 1 less than the front. Now instead of checking whether R is equal to size, R is not equal to size minus 1 to verify whether the queue is full or there is a space in the queue, now this condition can be used. Now this condition can be used to verify whether the queue is full or not. So this is the condition which can be used to just print the message that okay, the queue is full now and you can't insert. What is the condition? Condition is rear is not equal to front minus 1. So if this condition is false, that the rear is not equal to front minus 1, if this condition is false, that means there is a space, and this condition was false in the earlier case. Here, in this case, rear was not equal to front minus 1. What is front minus 1? Front minus 1 was index was 1. So if I say front is at pointing at 1 and minus 1, it will result into 0. This will result into 0, but my rear was pointing to index number 3. So of course 0 is not equal to 3. 0 is not equal to 3. That means there is a space. After verifying that there is a space, we have applied formula current index plus 1 modulus 4 that has given us the value of the next index wherein I should go. So obviously that is a 0th index, and I have come at a particular first place. Now in this new state, if we again try to insert a value, now this formula will come in picture, that whether the queue is full or not. So at this new state, when the R is pointing to the 0th index, let's say 0, and the front is pointing to 1, and this front is pointing to the index 1, this is the 0th index, and there is a 13 and 14 in the array, this is 12 and this is 15 we have inserted. Now if we verify, what is the value of front? Again, value of front is 1, minus 1, this will result into 0, which is equal to rear. That means you can no longer insert a new element, or cannot insert or enqueue new element in the queue. Let's try removal. Sorry. Let's say we perform two dequeue operations, and after dequeuing the elements from the queue, this will be the new state. The rear is pointing to the 0th index, and there is a 15, and the front, after two removals, front has come to the last index, wherein we have kept 14 value, number 14. Now, traditionally, our assumption was if the front and rear are at the end, that means there is no longer an element available. If you remove this element, then front traditionally should go to minus 1, but that's not the case. How you will verify whether there is an element in the queue or not? That should be R is not pointing to minus 1. Unless and until R is not going to point minus 1, that means there is always an element to remove from the queue. But in this case, what is the value of front index? Front index is pointing to 3, and the rear is pointing to 0. So after removing this 3, I am at the highest index. So in the normal queue, I may have said that F should point to minus 1 because I am at the highest index of the queue. But as there is an element, rear element, still one more element pointed by rear, which is at the index 0, the formula to increment the front will also change. So what is the formula to increment front? The same thing. Front, new front form will be present front index plus 1 and take mod of this with the size of the array. Size of the array is 4. So present front is 3. 3 plus 1, it will go to the 4. 4 mod 4, it will 0. Now the front will come to the 0. Now front and rear both are pointing to the same index, and if you still dequeue operation, then you should say that as there is only one element in the queue, because front and rear are pointing to same index, now you can set the F and R to minus 1. Now this is about coming from the last index to the first index, whether it will work to travel for in between indices. So it does work. For example, let's say, let me just reduce this diagram. Let's say this is the situation in the array. Let's say this is the new situation in the array. This is the array of size 5. So that we have to take care of 1, 2, 3, 4. And let's say front is pointing to index 1. There is a 12. And let's say 13 is there. And 14 is there, and this is my rear, for a simple example. So if I want to remove this one index, first index element, and go to the second index, let's verify whether the formula still works or not. So what is my current, what is the formula? Front plus 1 modulus the size. In this case, the size is 5. So the front plus 1 modulus 5. What is front? Front is pointing to 1. 1 plus 1, that is 2. If you take 2's remainder with the 5, it will result into 2, and the front will go to the next index, which is 2. And this will work for all the indexes, from the 0th index to all the way to the last index, which is 4. And this formula can be used to increase the front by 1 or the rear by 1. In the circular queue, we have to take care of just two special conditions, that the even the array is same linear array, logically because of our operations we are working in the array space like this. So because of our formula, array has acquired this kind of a shape. So let's say this is the 0 1, or let's say 0 1 2 and 3, and this is the fourth index. So we have to take care that the front and rear are not pointing to the same value. If this is the true, this means there is only one element in the queue. So after this, you must make sure that the front and rear will point to -1. The second thing, how you will identify the queue is full of what? The difference between front and rear should be more than one. If let's say rear is equal to front -1, so this condition you can verify. This condition you can check whether the queue is full or not. Unless and until you are not coming to this particular position, you can say that there is a space available in the queue, and you can increase the rear value and insert a new element in the queue. You can verify this. Let's say initially front is here and rear is pointing to the second index here, and let's put some elements 1, 2, and 3. Now front, if you remove it, it will come to the 1 with the same formula. Front, what is the value of the front? 1 plus 1 mod size. If the 1 plus 1 is 2, 2 mod 5, you will come to the 2 second index. What is the value of rear if you are enqueuing element? What is the size of where is the rear pointing? Rear is pointing to the index 2. So 2 plus 1 mod size. There are 4 elements. There are 4 indexes. That means the size is 5. So 3 mod 5 will result into 3. So rear will point from the second index. It will start pointing to the third index. Now you can keep the next element here, and this wheel will keep on rotating without any problem. Just two special conditions, that is, rear must not be one less than the front, or they are both not pointing to same indexes. Though this care should be taken. If they are both pointing to the same indexes, then while removing, make sure that you are setting up front and rear both to -1, indicating that the queue is empty now. And if rear is one less than the front, then the queue is full. So these two special conditions you have to take care in the case of a circular queue. Otherwise, this formula will seamlessly enqueue the elements and dequeue the elements from the queue. So this is the example of a circular queue. So is the theory clear of circular queue, or any doubt in the linear queue and the circular queue? Anyone have a doubt, or we are very clear with what is the queue and what is the circular queue? What is the limitation of a regular queue, and how the circular queue overcomes it? Thank you. Anyone have a doubt? Anyone have a doubt? We are going to implement this programs. So I've tried to give a pseudocode logic how a programmer should think of implementing a simple linear queue and a circular queue with the help of array. So this will be the next two assignments in the data structures. Like the task number 7 will be the implementation of a simple queue, and the task number 8 will be the implementation of a linear queue with the help of the array. Okay, now about the applications. What are the applications of queue? So let me clear the screen. So in the case of computer science, which specific to the computer science, let's say you have some jobs that you want to execute. Okay. And there is a processor which is going to execute this task P. And there are 10 jobs, let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, and or let's say 5 jobs we have which we want to execute. So obviously, the processor will take the job from the front. And if there is a new job, the user of the system will insert the new job at the rear. So this is called as a process scheduling queue or scheduling queue. You will learn about scheduling queues in detail in the subject called as operating system. So this is one of the application of a queue. Okay, scheduling of a processes in computer's memory. Now, there is one issue with this simple queue. That is, let's say, for example, I will assign some times to this jobs. Let's say there are we have five tasks. Task number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. There are 5 tasks. The task number 1 needs 20 minutes. Task number 2 needs 10 minutes. Task number 3 needs only 2 minutes. Task number 4 again needs, let's say, 15 minutes. And task number 5, let's say, needs only 1 minute. Now, if we look at the time quantum of each task, time required for each task to complete, and if we sum up, what will be the average time taken by the system to execute these all tasks? So it will be sum of all these time required divided by number of tasks. So that will be the average time taken by the task, we can say. But if we look at this, we can say we are kind of giving injustice to the task number 3 and 5. Why? Because they need a very small amount of time. Task number 3 needs only 2 minutes and task number 5 needs only 1 minute. But as we are doing this kind of first come, first serve, first in, first out kind of a job because of a queue, we are kind of doing injustice to task number 3 and task number 5 because they are taking very less number of time, machine cycles to execute. So in this case, somebody, the programmers have written some approaches wherein we call them as in a priority queue. Priority queue. So what happens in this case is you decide some sort of criteria. So let's say in this case, we are deciding the criteria is time, how much time is taken by a process. So if I decide that I will use time taken by a process as in a priority value, lesser the time, higher the priority. The lesser the time process takes, I'll give the higher the priority. So what will happen is I will just sort this array based on that priority, based on the priority. And how I'm assigning a priority, the process should take the less time, the process will have a highest priority. So how many processes we have? We have 5 processes. The less time taken by the process is process number 5. The process number 5 will come in the first because it takes only 1 minute of a time for the execution. Then the second process is process number 3. So I will execute the third process because it takes only 2 minutes of a time. Then third process is process number 2 because it takes 10 minutes. Then the next is process number 4, takes 15 minutes. And the last is process number 1 called as with the time requirement of 20. This how, if we apply this, it will drastically reduce the average processing time required by a task. Okay, how you will figure out by mathematical formula, just work on this, you will figure out how it is reducing the average time taken by a system to execute a particular task. So this is one example of what is called as a priority queue. Again, this is the example of process scheduling from the operating system. There is again something called as a memory management. So there is a pool of memory. Let's say there is a pool of memory, memory block 1, memory block 2, memory block 3, memory block 4, memory block 5. So this is a finite resource and you keep on allocating these memory blocks to the processes. Let's say there are a few processes. Process 1 needs 3 memory blocks. So what you'll do is you will allocate the first 3 blocks to the process 1. Okay. Then there comes process 2, which says that, process 2, which says that I need 2 memory blocks. So you will allocate remaining 2 memory blocks to the process 2. Now these 2 blocks have been allocated to process 2. After some time, let's say process 1 have terminated and it releases the first 3 blocks which were allocated. Now these 3 blocks will be returned to the queue. This is called as a memory pool. I can call it as a memory pool. So this is the queue. And now if P3 comes in picture, which says that, oh, I need only 1 block. So you can take 1 block from this memory pool and allocate it to the process 3. So again, memory management is again an example of queue data structures in the terms of computer science. There are many applications, like say if I am executing some sort of reservation, implementing some sort of a reservation window, for example, IRCTC. If you take an example of IRCTC portal and if there is a ticket reservation system going on, the one who enters the system first will get the highest priority because they must have implemented a priority, the queue-based algorithm, the one who enters the queue will have a priority over the seat. So obviously that's an application of a queue, logic of a queue is been implemented by IRCTC while providing the railway reservation. The same will be done by the travel agencies or maybe the hosting agencies, which are providing the flight bookings and the hotel bookings. The person who enters the system may be in the first in the queue and will get the highest priority over the available resources, available rooms, available bogies, available number of seats. So this is the application of queue data structure in the computer science. So any doubt in this theory also, what are the applications of queue? These are just 2-3 applications that I'm discussing. Later, when we will go with the tree and graph data structures, you will find other specific to data structure applications. We are going to implement a PBL in which you will need this queue structure to solve some problems with the help in terms of, let's say, tree structure and a graph structure, traversal techniques. And therein also, you'll find again, we have to make use of a queue structure. Okay, so any doubt till this point? Any doubt in circular queue or a simple queue or a application of a queue? Or what is front, what is rear, how to increment them? What is the formula, how to check and queue is full, how to check queue is empty? Anyone have a doubt? Or shall I assume that in the next lab session, if I set the task that implement the queue, everyone will be able to implement it? Thank you. Okay. So in the I recommend you to just go and check the task number 6 on the Moodle. It is the extension of a task number 5. In the task number 5, we have implemented a push and pop function as a cases in the main method. Like case 1 was indicating a push function and case 2 was indicating a pop function. Now I've put some restrictions. There is a notepad file which is putting some restrictions like don't make stack and pop that top variable as in a global members or a program members. Make them, these two variables should be declared in the main method. Then your program should have two functions called as in a push and pop, and this function should actually push function should actually insert a number and pop function should actually remove a number from the stack. So read that statement. We will proceed on the same ground. Like I will put a problem statement for queue, and I will allow you people to implement NQ and DQ functions as in a case. Case 1 may be the NQ and case 2 might be the DQ. So that will be the level 1 of submission, task number 7. And the task number 8 will be like actually declaring function NQ, which will NQ the element in the queue, and actually declaring a function called as DQ, which will actually DQ the element from the array. So task number 7 and task number 8 on the same similar grounds of stack and its extension. First level with the cases, second level with the functions. Okay, any doubt? So this is about stack and queue, and we have to revisit the concept of memory management again, because we will be starting with something called as a linked list. Now it's in a funny part, because linked list itself is a data structure, but with the help of a linked list, we can implement a stack and we can implement a queue. We can also implement a circular queue. So what we will do is we will understand the memory. We will revisit the concept of memory management that we have covered on one of the Sundays, and we will implement a stack or a queue with the help of a linked list. So this is how we will learn linked list. So there are some types of linked list. Singly linked list, double linked list, then the what we can say, a circular queue with the linked list. So the last node will be pointing to the first node, kind of a story. Okay, so this stack and queue is not ending here, because as soon as we complete the linked list, we are going to implement the same programs with the help of logic of linked list. We are going to re-implement the stack. We are going to re-implement the queue again. So this will be the task number 9 and task number 10 somehow. Okay. Great. Okay. So one more announcement. I am planning to conduct a test on Moodle. So prepare for that. It will be considered as one of the IC components. With the discussion of with the other two course teachers, the task will be made available on the Moodle, and it will be in particular time period, and you have to perform the task. What will be the nature? The nature of the task will be strictly on the unit number one. That means it will be it will consider all the programming skills. Like it will be testing your C skills basically, because in the unit number one, that is what we are focusing more. Okay. So let's stop here. See you in the practical sessions. You can leave the meeting.